must be lights burning brighter somewhere. Got to be birds flying higher in a sky more blue.
Good morning. Welcome to Right Thinking with Steve Coplon. I'm your host, Steve Coplon, and thank you for tuning in. Let's have a great day.
Good morning, everybody. Glad to be with you. Well, as you learned last week, I'm doing a new series called Right Thinking, Life, Money, Relationships with Johnnie Lloyd. And the responses that I've got from you on last week's show have been overwhelming for me. It's just wonderful, and I thank you. I think part of it is that I think you're sensing that there's going to be some practical tools that you're going to get out of these shows. And so we're just going to pick up today. I got Johnnie on with me right now, and we're going to pick up today with the second in the series on Right Thinking. And here's today, episode 227. Right Thinking with Steve Coplon is very pleased to announce that this week's show is called When You Set Your Goals, They Are Easier to Achieve, with guest Johnnie Lloyd. Tune in here, Steve and Johnnie continue their series on Right Thinking, this week focusing on setting and achieving goals. Steve introduces his topic papers, a tool to help budget your way to success. Well, Johnnie, what do you think about that?
You know, the thing about it is that, number one, I think is amazing. Let's first of all say that. That being able to come to a space and gather information and then find applicable and practical steps where it impacts your life is something that is so needed right now, because there's so many venues of information. And so getting something that goes right to the core of making an impact to your holistic, your whole picture of your life is major. So that's what goals do. Goals are amazing. And most people look at goals as, you know, just a check mark. However, when you do it strategically, it will actually pivot your life in such a way that it would take steps toward whatever you desire in life. And that's what goals do. So I love the thought of having goals. They're not to limit us. Actually, goals give us strength in space where we can empower ourselves to do what we desire to do toward our definite major purpose, whatever that purpose is, whatever our desire is. That's what goals do. Most people look at goals, Steve, as something that, well, if I write this down as a goal and I don't accomplish it, then there's something wrong. No, goals help is like a bow and arrow. It's the target. And what we do is we go toward that target. We literally, I love archery, and you pull out the arrow from your quiver and then you take and you aim. Sometimes you hit the bullseye. Sometimes you hit one of the other circles, but most of the time you will hit the target. Now, there are times in my life where I have went toward a goal and I was completely off. I mean, completely off. And even in that, having that goal allowed me to strategically realign myself to do better the next time. So that's what I think. I think this is going to be a great segment, and I'm looking forward to hearing what you have to say about goals as well.
Well, thank you, Johnnie. What I'm looking forward to is having you give me some responses to what I've been doing for a long time with these topic papers. And the topic papers that I came up with is my way of easing people into getting their goals figured out and then realizing that through proper financial handling of their affairs, they can have a better chance to achieve those goals. And almost everything that's in my teachings for how to have a better life through getting your finances in order is built into the topic papers. And the topic papers will be introduced today, but the exercises are going to follow, not necessarily today, because when we start, you're going to realize that I think you've got to have a foundation to build a building. You can't just do the proverbial house of cards where you just build something, you know, that's flimsy, that's going to fall right down. And the topic papers, I developed them, oh, I don't know, a number of years ago, but I used them in a high school called Achievable Dream Academy.
Oh yeah.
And it's a wonderful program, and it's pretty much for at-risk kids. But the beautiful thing is that this program puts about 98% of their high school graduates, they go to college. And that's a remarkable statistic for an at-risk community. But here's what it is. When I got into teaching high school kids, starting at about 14 years old, freshman in high school, about financial literacy, I knew they weren't ready to just have a straight textbook on how to do these different tools. I mean, the basic standard things that are in most courses on budgeting and, you know, how money and banking and all those kind of things work, because they're not listening. They're not ready to listen. And so I had to do something to give them, like, to where they want it to get more. And so last week when we did our first show in this series, I asked everyone to be patient. And so I'll say this again to everyone that's listening. Thank you for giving Johnnie and I the opportunity to address this topic. And, you know, if you're a quote unquote very successful person doing well in your life, good finances, everything in order, well, maybe we can help you think about something that'll help you do even better. But if not that, perhaps you'll learn something about how to pass on what you've already achieved to some others that are in great need. Look around. Are all your kids doing as well and focused on the things that you want them to focus on? So anyway, today, just we'll go ahead and get started on this here. But we told you last week that over the series of shows, we are going to give you tools. We're going to give you budget tools. But one thing I've learned in a lot of programs that I've done, more with adults than high school kids, most adults are very impatient. Okay, I already know that. Will you give me something I don't know kind of attitude? And I'm like, hey, I'm doing the best I can. But I've got a concept, Johnnie, and I think it's Swiss cheese is what I call it, Swiss cheese. If you've got to build a foundation and you got to have strong building blocks, think about a piece of Swiss cheese. I love Swiss cheese. It's delicious. Swiss cheese, though, is got holes all through it. That's the trademark of when you see a piece of Swiss cheese. It's got all these holes through it. Well, you don't want your foundation to have holes through it. And so what I try to do is I talk about Swiss cheese and your foundation, even some of the most competent adults, maybe there's just one thing that we can fill in some of their holes just to make it better. And I'll tell you, if a person's got an open mind and they're already successful, maybe they will go, you know what? I hadn't looked at it that way before. So you made a comment a minute ago, Johnnie, about goal setting, because that's today's theme. One thing that I try to tell people is set your goals high. Set your goals high, because think about the math. If you set your bar really high, the goal really high, and you work toward it and you come up short of your goal, but you set your goal really, really high, you're going to be in a really good place, even though you didn't quite reach your goal. And so, you know, just don't put yourself down because you didn't completely reach your goal. Just enjoy the step, the journey as you get there. And if you don't quite reach your goal, refocus and say, you know what? First time out of the box, I got 80% toward where I was headed. now maybe I just need to rest and regroup myself, and that next 20% will come easy. And what you can do when you set goals, and I think this is a secret, I'm going to turn it over to you because I've heard you speak on this subject before. If you set a goal and you come up about 80% of that goal, and then you refocus like I'm suggesting, you can have that 20% that's left on the goal that you set to be the first part of another goal that includes the completion of your last goal. In other words, we're always redefining our goals and going further. When we stop having goals and direction that we're trying to get to, we become stagnated. Johnnie, what do you think about that part of the conversation?
Well, Steve, I'm going to start with stagnant. What I would like to say is that goals for me are like water. They flow. They flow. They have a movement that happens, right? So when water is stagnant or sit in a place, what happens is it becomes stale. Typically, it ends up, especially if it's a body of water, then what happens is it also ends up with algae and all of these other things end up growing on top of the water because there's no flow. Water that flows, the movement alone causes the water to stay in a more healthier state. Even though, like they said, rivers, you know, some things are tributaries and all of that, but it flows. So when you flow, you're going in a direction. So one of the things is something moving. When you're moving, it is easier to redirect yourself than when you're sitting still. It takes more energy to move or to start movement when you're sitting still than if you're already in motion. So the motion is very important. So moving forward is very important. Now, what I liked about what you were saying, too, is that me talking about it before, and I'm going to talk about it a little bit differently today. I talked about water, right? So let's talk about GPS, Global Positioning System. So let's call it Goal Positioning System. Mm. So right. You put your goal, right, is your destination. The first thing you need to know, our first tip today, is you need to know where you are. So you need to assess where you are right now in order for your goal to be more powerful and more directive. Because if you don't know where you are, it's hard to tell your GPS system, your goal positioning system, where you want to go if you don't know where you are. So it's just like our GPS systems in our vehicles or the phone or whatever. It says, can I locate you? You have to give it permission, give yourself permission to identify where you are right now today. Now, most people look at that and say, well, I don't want to talk about where I am, because where they are is not where they desire to be, or they try to blame, shame themselves regarding that, right? They want to put it off on someone else or whatever. So whether it's a company that is not currently where it desires to be, or it's an individual that is not currently where they desire to be, it is about where you are now, right? And where do you want to go? So anytime I put a destination in my goal positioning system, and I decide that, you know what, I thought I wanted to go there, but now I need to go somewhere else, then I get a chance to change my location where I want to go. I am empowered to do that. So when we don't do that, then any road will take us nowhere. Any road will take you nowhere. You want to go somewhere. And the thing about it is, anytime we're heading for something that's a goal, we have to determine not just where we are, first thing, right? You also have to determine what you're willing to do in exchange to get to that goal. Whether that is a little bit more self-discipline, or it's adding something new to what you're doing. So what I do is I stop looking at the things I can't do. Like, I have some goals before me, right? I don't look at it from the perspective of what I cannot do. I look at it from the perspective of what I need to do or desire to do to get to the goal. That's all it is. And I take it in small bites. And there's nothing wrong with having, and I do, I have some huge goals before me, right? So what I do is I said, okay, if you're driving from here, global, right, positioning system or goal positioning system, and you want to get to California, you know you're going to have to make some stops unless you're on a plane. And even on a plane, based on where you're coming from, you're not going to have a direct flight. So there's going to be some landing and taking off. There's going to be some stopping and getting gas. There are some stops that you need to make on the way there. Their part, I'm going to use the word you use because I love that word, is part of the journey. It's part of the process of getting there. And so anytime we're changing, transforming, or setting goals, goals are before us. Goals are something we desire to head toward. Most people don't look at behind them and say, well, my goal is to go back to something that is behind me, right? Most people, even if a greater success or success was behind them and they lost it and they're at that point right now, like coming through the pandemic, a lot of companies, a lot of people saying, well, you know, my net worth or this happened to me or I lost a job or whatever. Look at it from the perspective of now what? Because crisis will always exist in our life in some form or another. So now looking at our situation, where are we located and what do we want now? Because crisis, any crisis, helps us provide clarity for our next move. It provides clarity. So in crisis or adversity, or what some people may consider defeat, it's about, okay, I'm here now. Now what? That's the question. Not I can't, but how can I move forward? If something happens, how can I do this now? So looking for the mechanism that would drive us, that would allow us, when I say drive, I'm saying mentally, emotionally, physically, that would physically pivot us or push us or support us moving forward. And that's what goals are. Goals are literally, where do you want to land? Where do you have your target at? Where do you want to, you know, to thrive? Where's the next step? So that's why for me and the flowing, going back to the water, even when I get to the new goal, I look at it and I say, okay, now what? Now what's next? I celebrate the arrival that I've made, you know, whatever it is. I celebrate that. I enjoy that for whatever time period in your life. Enjoy the wonderful small things, the big things that are happening in your life, because you want to take a moment to breathe, right? Then a reassess and then move forward to whatever your next level of greatness or your next goal that you have in your life. It's a momentum. I hope that makes sense.
Oh, Johnnie, you know what I like about what we're doing is you are so wonderful for me as far as the goals that I've set in my life, because I've done a lot of things in financial literacy teaching. You know, I've had a lot of experiences, a career and so forth. But to have someone else that I greatly respect, my friend, be able to share what I do and pass comment on it like you just did. You know, you said something that was pretty much the same as I said, but you made it come to life. And so it's always good to have more than one person's perspective. That's the difference between a forum and a lecture by one person.
Right.
And so what I want to do right now is I'm going to ask you one really quick question.
Okay.
And give me a really quick answer, because I want to make an invitation to everyone that's listening. We're going to get into these topic papers, and if you want a copy of the topic papers, just contact me through righthink.org, righthink.org. Hit the contact button. I'll get your email. You can message. We can start communicating. But I'll send you a set of these topic papers. But I want to get started on them, Johnnie, but I want to just make this one comment. Johnnie, don't you think that it's a lot nicer to be able to have money than to not have money, so that you can be able to do things that you want to do, little things, not have stress, just to have that kind of freedom that you just don't have to go through life just struggling because you don't have finances that will make your life easy?
Okay, so I'm going to say yes, and oh my goodness, yes.
Exactly.
You know, just absolutely yes. And let me just tap one thing that you said. Stress is one of the major things that people deal with in their life that will attack their bodies from the inside out. And if or when people are stressed about not having the resources that they need, that is an attack that happens from the inside out. So not having enough of, and we're going to talk about money today, but not having the resources that you need is not a place people desire to be. So the question is how do you move from where you are, regardless of how much money that is, because money is relative. You can make $1 million a year, but if you spend $1,000,001, you're in the hole, right? You can make $10,000 a year and spend $9,000 and you're in the profit. You have gain. So it's not how much money you make, it's how much money that you spend. And all of this is connected to the topic papers that that you're relating to.
Well, good. So what I want to do is this. There's six papers in my topic papers, and each one gives a little bit of questions for people to put some thought into. And the very first one, we're not going to go over the 8 questions in the first one.
Okay.
I just want to put them out, and then you can put a comment on them. But we're not going to define them. We're not going to answer these questions other than to. Here's my point. My first topic paper is specifically related to money, but the second and then third might not be in your mind. But that's what we're trying to show you. John and I told you last week that we want to help you change your thinking. One of the comments we got from one of our listeners was, I've never thought about money the way that y'all are talking. When we talked about the part in particular about living within your means, of course we want to live within our means and not get into debt, not get into credit card debt, all those things. But what I said last week that we talked about was, go further than being stuck within your means. Just don't say, well, I'll never be able to do that because I don't make enough money. There's different ways that you can take what you already have. You brought that out beautifully last week, Johnnie, and do more with it if you eliminate distractions and wastefulness. And then maybe you can learn how to make more. But if you don't set goals, you'll just be kind of like cruising through life, just just being kind of unhappy because you don't have more. That's what I'm trying to say. But the first one is I do this with everybody just to show them maybe you don't know as much as you think you know, so that perhaps you might want to listen. That's all this next one's for. So here's the first topic paper. It's called Budget, Cash Flow, Loans, and Credit Cards. These are 4 financial terms right up. First question, what does the term reconcile mean in regard to a checking account with a bank? Now, Johnnie, I said we weren't going to talk about it much, but I just want to give a quick statement on each one and get you to give me a statement back. I'm pointing out how you reconcile a bank account. I don't know how many people bother to do that anymore, but the secret to question 1, what does the term reconcile mean in regard to a checking account with a bank? It's not about money. It's not about a bank. It's because I want to talk about the word reconcile. Johnnie, what do you think of when you hear the word reconcile?
When I think of the term reconcile, I look at the word re, right? The prefix re means to come back to their original expenses, because I don't know if people look at it like this, but banks make mistakes and people make mistakes, right? I've looked at my in my life. When you reconcile something, you take a second look at something to confirm it is correct.
Oh, beautiful.
So that's what reconciliation is.
That's exactly where I go. Accurate. Mm-hmm. You got it right. What types of things do we reconcile in life, Johnnie?
Wow. You're going to make me sit up.
Okay, no, this is a quick hit.
Quick hit. Okay. So let's look at relationships.
Oh, that's number one.
We look at money. We look at our goals, you know, our lifestyle. How does it align and reconcile with what you say you want? So how does those things happen? And we look at even friendships. When I say relationships, I'm saying friendships, marriage, all of that. And then lifestyle, reconcile, to reconsider what you desire versus what you go.
You get an A++. And I'll just put one last thought on and go to the second question. When we reconcile, we're trying to make sure that we're not fooling ourselves and deviating from the truth. Because we get into these topic papers, one of the reasons that people don't reach their goals, it's because they're not being honest with themselves. Because I didn't really want that anyway. Yeah, you did. Don't tell me you didn't, because you didn't find a way to discipline yourself to hang in there long enough to do what you needed to do. You know, a lot of it's back on yourself. Question two, when borrowing money, what three variables determine how much the monthly payment will be for a loan?
One of the things is your credit score. Which is basically one of the things that they look at, one of the variables that they consider before they determine how much you're going to pay on the loan. What is the other two, Steve?
Your credit score is an excellent one. And again, this is just to open up. How much you want to borrow? How long you're going to take to pay it back the term? So it's principal, term, and what the rate is. Now, the rate is a function. The rate is a function of your credit score. So your answer is correct. It's just getting deeper into it.
Right.
But what I'm trying to say is, if people really want to do better with their finances, these eight questions are just putting a little bit out there that we can spend the next couple months teaching them all the details. Because right. What you just said about credit score, we can get into, I've done whole seminars.
On credit, right.
On credit. You know, what does credit score mean? How do you get a better credit score? What do you need to do to make sure it's good? How do you establish credit? So, yeah, we're on to that one.
So let me tell you one more thing on the money. A lot of times in our life, people will say, how much do you, this is the key. This is one of the tips. When a person asks you, how much do you want your monthly payment to be? That is the wrong question. Because I can stretch your loan out in such a way that your payment will be what you want, but the item that you're purchasing won't even be any good by the time you finish paying for it for 5 or 6 years. So it's not how much the payment's going to be. Look at all of those other pieces that Steve just lifted up and things we'll talk about in the future to consider the payment, not just how much it's going to be per month.
Johnnie, one of my favorite little kid jokes about pizza, eating a pizza. It's the person slicing the pizza says, do you want me to cut it in 6 slices or 8 slices? And the person's response is, just cut it in 6 because I'm not that hungry today. Yeah, it's just a different way to sell people something.
That's right.
For those of you that didn't understand it, if you're going to eat a whole pizza, 6 slices, even though it seems less, you're eating the same amount of the pizza, please. Okay. Three, what is an amortization table? It's, you know, I told you we weren't going to give answers, but I guess we are. You know, it's a tool to see what your loan looks like, but it's important so that you can plan what you're doing, just like you said, Johnnie. Mm-hmm. By the way, when you go on a longer term to pay that loan back, it's going to cost you more interest, period. Okay. Four, when borrowing money, what is an APR?
Annual percentage rate. Woo!
What's that got to do with the amount of money that you're borrowing?
Because based on the annual percentage rate, you're going to end up paying more in interest, right?
That's very good.
And so a lot of people go to the quick stop shops and try to borrow money. And they say, you only got to pay this this amount when you return it in 30 days or 40 days. Remember, you need to take that, whatever that is, and take it over the annual period, right? To really determine what you're paying in interest. Because some of the places that people are going to may be called, I mean, it may be 30%, 60%, 300% based on what they're charging you. So look at that. And when you have a budget or when you have goals, it will back you away from those quick fixes that could impact the rest of your well-being. Because this is what this is about. This is about us all being in a better place by being more knowledgeable about the resources we have in our hand.
Johnnie, what we're getting to, and I got six pages of this, and it's quick. And obviously, we're probably not going to get as far into it as I thought, because you're finding an interest in it, which I love. But here's my thing. When we start talking about these variables and the purpose of this first sheet, I want people to know that everything I'm talking about, you need to know a lot about, because it affects you. And if you don't learn ultimately to do the last step, you're not going to be able to see the effect of all these things on you, and you're going to be operating in the dark, so to speak. Now, here's one that is very, very important. What is a consolidation loan? And I want to skip over it with just one thought, and that is sometimes when you got a whole lot of stuff hanging out there, it's best to just put it all in one bucket and deal with it. Consolidate it so that you can move on. And I've got tools that with consolidation of debt. And when people say, well, what if you can't get a loan? What if you don't have enough credit to get a loan? Well, that's when you get into other aspects of character, having someone maybe stand up for you and say, you know what, I want to help this person move forward. A lot of people done that for me. If I didn't have people co-signing a loan for me in my life when I've had health crisis and other things, I wouldn't be here talking and teaching today. But so we're going to get into consolidation loan. Hey, I hope that all of you that are following this, don't worry about taking notes. Just contact me through the website and I'll send this to you on a PDF file. How are credit card finance charges calculated? You see, people use credit cards all day long, but they don't know what they're paying because they don't know how those fees work. And we'll teach you more about credit cards in future lessons. What is a budget? Now we're getting down to the brass tacks, Johnnie. I know that you can't wait. So you've already talked about what a budget is. It gives you flexibility in your life to see things. But here's the one that I have built my whole career around. What is cash flow? You know, everybody's heard the expression, time is money. That's one thing. Or cash is king in business, things like that. But what is cash flow? I will teach you through the series that Johnnie and I are doing, and Johnnie will teach you how money comes in and money goes out in many, many ways to keep it focused. Because first of all, the whole concept of money coming in, you got to have a source of money. You got to have a job. You got to have money coming in from some investments. You got to have it flowing in, and you want to have that as large as possible, as much as possible. But if you can't be as much as possible, you want to be very careful how you use it so that you make sure you cover your priorities and you need to know them. So that's the first topic paper: budget, cash flow, loans, and credit cards. Johnnie, just a real quick statement on those 8 points. Are they important?
Well, I would like to talk about them from three perspectives, if I may. One is I'll talk about it from the personal perspective. The more together we have our financial resources, it will impact our time management and our life management. Because when you start setting goals in one area of your life, you'll start seeing the benefit of those goals in that area. But it will impact other areas of your life as a person, right? So now we have that individual who is now is very time conscious, who's money conscious, who's going to walk into a company And they're going to be conscious of how they spend the money in the company because they have the same skill set comes into the office with them. And so they'll start looking and saying, hey, you know, and establishing goals for their job that they're doing because they will have more productivity and more profitable for the company. Let's take it to a nonprofit. Nonprofits, the same situation. When nonprofits look at all of these things we're going to talk about, then what happens is they're able to more by stewardship, become the best steward possible of the resources that they have coming in for people who believe in the mission, the vision, the purpose, right? So no matter where you are in this time, money continuum is what I'm going to call it for right now for this very second, is that no matter where you are, where you're feeding the economy in such a way that is positive. Because when you have excess, you get a chance to have opportunities. And when you have opportunities, it grows us in a social economic perspective, right? So it's the time money continuum. So it's not just, okay, well, I'm gonna have a better budget for me personally. So it's you having a better budget as an individual is going to impact every area of your life, every area, and every person that you touch, because then your children see that, you know, what you're doing. So you take that same information and you say, okay, I'm not just going to give you an allowance. I'm going to take and give you an allowance. Now you need to determine ABC, and you teach them, not just give them, because you're transforming their mindset from moving to being a consumer of wealth to a producer of wealth. And that is in the time money continuum. Because if you are only consuming, then all the resources that come into you, you basically, I don't want to use the term this, you basically release them right there. You know, so when you do the other way, that gives you options. Goals give you options.
Oh, yeah.
Flexibility gives you options.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
Johnnie, I got a new phrase that I don't know. I've never heard this phrase before, I don't think, but I'm going to put it out there today and we'll get a copyright on this term. Financial maturity. Because we're talking about life, how life, money, and relationships fit. We said everything we're going to do is going to try to help you have a better life. But we're trying to show people how when you understand what you want out of life, you know, that's what today's title really means, you know, just to kind of make it simple. When you set goals, they are easier to achieve. If, you know, you take that trip and you don't know which way you're going and you go down the wrong path too many times, you might not get to your destination. So set your goals. But the point is, this whole thing, and if you don't mind, I might call you Miss Einstein, because you're talking about the theory of relativity now as it relates to how your money and your life come together. So it's beautiful. So, and it's really true, though. That's what Einstein's really all about, the overall relationship of everything.
That's exactly.
Cosmos there. Okay, second topic paper. Now, I just hit you with a lot of financial terms that, by the way, I've done this to about 1,000 people just in surveys. The average correct answer that everybody knew, all 8 of those concepts, terms, whatever we call them, 1.5 correct answers. And that's a blend between mostly adults and some high school kids. Most people, they just don't know those answers because I don't need to know that. You know, I mean, I already got a credit card. I do this, I do that. I'll go to the bank and get a loan. But no, just so you put it in perspective, most people that unless they're a financial, you know, certain type of a background, most people just do not, the average person does not know but 1.5 of those questions, okay? Now I'm going to take a full deviation because this is who you and I are, Johnnie. This is our approach to trying to help people. And we talk about what's unique about us. Johnnie, there are literally thousands and thousands of financial counselors. There are literally thousands of teachers that will teach you all aspects of money, management, budgets, investing, about credit, whatever. But not everybody wants to relate it to a better life to achieve goals. And so that's who we are. And I can tell you, I know you have, and I've had tremendous success with many, many people for years to where they catch on to what I'm trying to show them. Because, Johnnie, you had a book or a show you did with me called When You Are Focused, You're on Fire. What's the name of that exactly?
You Are Fire When You're Focused.
Okay. And basically, being focused is important. It all goes back to purpose. Goals is like a subset of once you know your purpose. So, you know, we said we weren't going to get deep into that, but everything that we're doing is based on knowing your purpose. When you have a burning desire and never quit. Now, the next set of topic papers, real simple. If I can just get through in the next 10 minutes with you what the topic papers are, we'll pick back up next week. And today I'm offering, and this is not a KTEL, that used to be an old TV thing where they had TV things to buy, you know, call this 800 number. No, this is not an 800 number. This is a support hotline. This is free. We love you. We want to do this for you. We're not selling you anything. You know, we're just trying to share. That's all. Johnnie, this next topic paper is called Success and Goals. And the first question, there's only two on this.
I know.
And I would spend a whole week in my high school class with these kids going around letting each one answer these questions. And I want to share something with you in a moment. What is your definition of success? People have to know that to get started. Johnnie, we're going to do just real brief. We'll come back to this page, but what is success, Johnnie?
Okay,
different,
so
different people.
Yes, it's different for different people. So let's talk about how to help our viewers find out what success is for them, right? So the first thing I would say is take a moment and look at what you think success is, not what other people tell you success is. Because remember, you got to pay the bill. You got to pay the bill for success. So what is success to you? And what are you willing to do to get it, to have whatever you think success is? Because when you look at social media, when you look at advertising, when you look at other people's life, then you're doing the competition of what success is for them. So you need to know what success is for you. So that's my thing.
We said in the introduction last week was basically the introduction to what we're going to be doing. And we said, we're going to teach you how to budget through this course, this program, these seminars, whatever we want to call them. This series, I think, is what we are calling it.
Yeah.
But we said, we're not going to define what it is for you. We're just going to teach you how to do it, help you define it. But then we're going to teach you how to put the money behind the planning to handle your money. But when we teach you budgeting, you're going to decide what items go into your budget. But we're going to teach you how it works. And the second part of success and goals topic paper, what are three of your goals in life? You know, this might seem simple, but I want people to focus on this page, because if you don't do this page, you're just going to be playing ping pong. You're going to be going through life with a lot of ups and downs. You're going to be a yo-yo. You're going to have a willy-nilly attitude. You're not going to be focused. You're going to be drifting through life without a purpose. And you're going to be just kind of out there as the wind blows. You're not going to be grounded. I could do this for a lot longer, you know, but Johnnie, we want people to figure out, to define, to know, what are the goals? Okay. Second topic paper after that. This is the third one. It's called Topic: A Good and Better Life. What would a good life be? Let's define what a good life looks like. And the second question, what can you do to have a better life? See where we're going with this? Now, you know, if you're not taking notes, which is fine, just this is all written out. It's just meditative type things. But Johnnie, I just want to say this. When I asked these questions in high school, this is just kind of to put it out there. A lot of different people have a lot of different ideas of what a good life looks like.
You know, the one thing I did do, Steve, with a better life and some success goals, and I did it in Department of Defense. I did a group of leaders, of executives with this, is I went in and it sounds a little funny, but I did a vision board where I brought in everything and they did a vision board. And on one side was their personal vision. And I had them leave the other side empty. Then we went and moved and said, now let's talk about the vision of the company, this entity you're working with. And then reminded them that by doing, helping with, and they had to structure their vision of their role in the company, right? And then they connected them to see how interrelated they are. So that's what I would do when doing this, especially if you're a family or your company or whatever, is to look at the opportunity of helping the people that your customer, your internal customer, find out what their goals and vision and success looks like for them and see how y'all interrelate, how you're interconnected. So one of the things I tell people is to stop fussing about your job. Your job is feeding you. It may not be the place that you want to be right now, but do the best you can do in that job because it's teaching you the habits you need to go to the next level and be the best you can be. So I just wanted to interject that for just a second.
Johnnie, I'm going to bring that back in a future episode because we want to teach people what a vision board, how to have one. And also one of the things that we're going to need to do there is we're going to have to talk about Maslow's hierarchy of needs somewhat, but without going into either one of those now, because we got about 5 minutes left in today's show, we're way behind in this, but I'm glad. So here's what it is, though. When employees know more of what they want and they're self-actualized and they're working in a company and they've gone through the vision type of a board that you're saying, an employer will have far, far better, happier, more productive employees, and the company will do much better. The employees will have better lives, and the world will be a better place, and we'll all have a Merry Christmas. So, Johnnie, I did want to give this one example, though. It's very serious, though. So in this high school class that I was going through this exercise about what would a good life be, success and goals, kids are raising their hands saying, I want to be an NFL football player. I want to make billions of dollars. You know, I want to have a big house. I want to marry a lawyer. I want to be a lawyer, whatever, you know. This one young lady, she raised her hand and she said, less violence in my home. And that puts a perspective on it, Johnnie. It's not about money. It's not about money. Money helps. It's not about money. But, you know, let's just try to get to this. Now, the next topic paper, financial stability and savings. You see a little transition I'm making here? We've gone from these heavy financial terms just to kind of let everybody know, well, maybe there is something you don't know that you could listen to. Then I'm going into goals, success, good life, better life. What is financial stability? I'll just say this about financial stability. When you have financial stability, there might be less violence in your home because there might be a whole lot less going on that's causing major problems. Drug addiction, selling drugs, prostitution, anything, you know, but just financial stability. Stability is a good thing. Now it's getting real specific. What is savings? Why is it good to have savings? Now, the fifth topic paper, I've been financial literacy teaching an accountant, teaching people finances, budgets, whatever. I'm 70 years old in 2 weeks, and I've been teaching since before I was 20, when I was first in college and was studying accounting in college, and I was mentoring a lot of people because I was doing it already. This one page is the core. Everything that I try to teach is built into this one page. We're obviously not going to teach it today, but I just want to tell you what the overview is. It's called Keeping Track of Spending. And what this page does is, this is where I've helped hundreds, maybe more, hundreds that I know of, and a lot of people that I've left my seminars and places conducting them. I ask everybody to take 1 hour tonight. Seclude yourself, cut off your cell phone, excuse yourself from your family, just put yourself into a room and shut the door, and give yourself 1 hour to reconstruct every penny that has gone through your fingers in your life, that you've spent in your life, that you've paid a bill or bought a Starbucks coffee or whatever. But I want you to reconstruct your life for the last 30 days, give or take. Doesn't have to be exactly 30, it can be 31 or 2, 20, it doesn't matter. But I want you to focus on your own life and look at everything that you've done that relates to money. And after you've done that, while you're doing it, I want you to take notes. And I want you to just jot down everything you can think of. And don't worry about the time order that you did it. If you did it yesterday, it can be at the top of the list. If you did it 30 days ago, it can be number two item. Doesn't matter. Put them all down and try to really think, analyze your life, reconstruct your behavior. What have you done for the last 30 days as it relates to money? And when you do this, if you think you've finished it in 15 minutes, make yourself keep going for the full hour. And why do I want you to spend an hour? Because you're worth it. You're worth it, Johnnie. Every one of you that's listening, you're worth it. You know, you're out there trying to vent through life, face life, do things, but you've just got to get control of it. But you got to understand what you're doing. And after you spend the time while you're in that hour, organize what you wrote down, put it into categories. Later on, I'm going to teach you how to put dates to when you have to spend the things that you spent. What time of the month do you pay your rent? What time of the month is the credit card payment due? When are the birthdays that you want to make sure you go bought a card or a gift? In other words, we're going to relate everything that you do with money to time frames so that I can teach you how to cash flow budget. See money in, money out. Throughout the course of your month into a year, you'll get to where it becomes second nature. You write it down in the beginning because there are always new things that you left out. But when you get good at that, and it might take a couple months. And I can tell you this, in my career, in my travels, I have helped thousands of people master this technique, and it has changed their lives. I have the most gratification of anything I've ever done in life when I teach people this. I've gotten people completely out of debt that they thought it was hopeless. So here's what I'm saying there, Johnnie. After I give people that exercise, I ask them, what did you learn? And almost across the board, the first thing that people say they learn, I learned that I didn't have a clue where my money was going. I didn't know what I was doing. Because a lot of people just put all their cash in their pocket and they, I got a couple hundred bucks I know I can spend. But you know what? If you've got pocket money, which is a good thing because you're paying all your bills and you got 200 bucks that you carry around in your pocket just to do what you feel like it without having an account because you're free. If you want to achieve a goal, if you want to reach a goal that you've set, you might realize that that $200 that you're spending on just anything because you're free, you can get the same types of things that you're spending that 200 on, cut it in half. Take that $100 over 3 months and buy yourself a new bicycle, buy yourself a new computer, take a vacation. You can redirect, and we're going to get into that later. And the biggest thing that I have that comes from this is called the substitution principle, because when you know what you're doing and you realize there's so much in there, the second thing that everybody learned, the first one was, I didn't really know what I was doing. The second one that they learn is I'm wasting an awful lot of my money doing things that I just don't really need, that have no value to me. Then I can teach people to start thinking, and it becomes in your mind to where people will go to a store, they'll put something on the counter, and they'll all of a sudden have a light bulb go off and say, I didn't need this, and they put it back on the shelf. And then it becomes savings. And then if you've answered questions and learned, why are savings important? So anyway, that's the, there's a whole exercise built into that one, but we're going to teach that one through this series of seminars. And then the last one is where the goal is for this program, and that's to teach people how to budget. And it's why it's important to write down your budget. Why is it important to write down your budget? How can budgeting help you reach your goals? Explain how the substitution principle and money handling and priorities work together. What is the difference in doing a budget using totals for the month and doing a weekly budget using cumulative balances? Why is doing a cash flow weekly budget a better way to budget than a monthly budget? Johnnie, those are the concepts. Those are the tools. And I know that today's show, maybe people didn't get any real specific, but I think we got their minds working. Johnnie, finish it up for us on what we're doing today and where this is going to go.
Okay, so I'm going to capsulize sort of to make sure that everybody, including us, are prepared and see the 30,000 foot view, if I could do that way, is that whether you're as an individual, as a company, as a nonprofit, a profit organization, when you look at your resources and you look at how the cash is flowing, remember I talked about money, I talked about water in the beginning, that's the flow. That's the flow. So when you have flow, you have flexibility. You get a chance to refresh your organization. You get a chance to refresh your life. You get a chance to make decisions about moving forward. Number one. Number two is when you look at your purpose or goals, let's start with goals. Then when you have goals and you start looking at your assets, whether they be your time, your money, your relationship, everything going through that, the goal becomes the filter that is on your phone, that when you look at the filter, it changes how the way you look. That's what the goal does. It changes the way you see. It changes the way that you others see you because you build in more self-awareness, self-control, those things. It's about self. It's about self-empowerment. So these this series is going to give you as an individual, as a company, as a nonprofit, it doesn't matter. It's going to give you ideas that trigger you in such a way that you are going to be better off in the end than you were in the beginning. Take the concepts and let them apply to your life where you are now. Take the concepts and become better because all of these things matter. Because money is a critical tool in all of our lives. So remember, we're looking at money, we're looking at relationships, we're looking at life because really we're moving the goal. Part of our goal is to move us from a silo, saying money is, you know, this is the silo for money, this is the silo for relationships, this is the silo for life, and saying we're merging all that together and saying this is the way we're going to live moving forward so that we're better off. So as a construct, make sure that you ask for the topic paper because it's going to help as you move forward, and you will get more information by already having some of the answers, and then look at from this. From also being connected, you will also be able to send questions back or ask questions to yourself to make sure that you have the greatest understanding of what's next for you as a person, as a business, or as a nonprofit.
Thank you, Johnnie. I've been using my cash flow budget where I put the dates down and I can see how money comes in and comes out for years now. And it focuses me. And when I'm focused, I do better. So there's a lot we're going to share with you. I thank you for listening, Johnnie. It's a dream come true for me to finally get to this level of my teachings and have someone that is sharing the teachings to teach them with me and bringing in more of what you do to complement what I do. And I think that we're going to have a wonderful gift for people if they just want to want to get to know us and go with it. So, Johnnie, thank you so much for today. God bless you. And I can't wait till we do this again next week.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Well, everyone, hope you enjoyed it. Make sure you reach out to us. Have a wonderful week. God bless you.
Thanks for listening to Right Thinking with Steve Copeland. I look forward to being with you again next week. And remember, don't quit. Plan ahead. It will get better. God bless you and have a great week.